formal press briefing. Once again, I'm joined by investigator in charge, Dr. Jennifer Rohde. Every evening, we have an update progress report on what the group has accomplished during the day, so I'm going to give you the basis of that. The first area will be instructors, and today we conducted a walkthrough along the runway area. Dr. Rohde, would you care to address that, please?
It's typical with any accident investigation that involves an airport environment for us to do a formal sweep of the runway for two purposes, to ensure that there was nothing with the airport environment that may have contributed to the event that we're investigating, and to ensure that there are not any components that may have separated from the airframe during the departure roll for the airplane.
So we're also in the process of the wreckage recovery now, as we are able to document exactly where things wound up, and I believe we'll be beginning transport on that.
That's correct. Our recovery team from Lone Star Retrieval out of Lancaster, Texas has arrived this morning. They're in the process of staging their equipment and separating the hangar components from airframe components, and slowly starting the process of bagging aircraft or airplane components for its later transport to a secure facility as we continue our investigation.
James, we have a minor problem here with the Microsoft wants an update. Thank you, Andrew. So this is an exemplar picture of the cockpit of the King Air 350, and you can see here the avionics suite inside the aircraft. And when we do an investigation, obviously we look to recover as much as we possibly can. Now, yesterday we talked about that we have a cockpit voice recorder. We did not have a digital flight data recorder. However, there are chips inside here, often with non-volatile memory, and we are able sometimes to recover the information that's on those chips. So this is the external view, which we released yesterday, of the cockpit voice recorder on the aircraft. And this is one of our lab technicians back in Washington, D.C., who is now taking the recorder apart. This shows one of the chips inside the recorder, and you can see that they are in pretty good condition. So as far as the other equipment on board the aircraft, that's not fire hardened or crash resistant, so that's going to be a work in progress to see how much we're able to recover. I'd now like to read you the information that we have on the cockpit voice recorder, and this is preliminary. The aircraft was equipped with an L3 FA2100 cockpit voice recorder, or CVR. Excuse me. The CVR recorded 2 hours of high quality audio, including the accident flight. The tower cleared the flight to take off from runway 15 about 1 minute before the end of the recording. Crew comment consistent with confusion occurred about 12 seconds before the end of the recording. Crew comment regarding a problem with the left engine occurred about 8 seconds before the end of the recording. 3 automated bank angle oral alerts began about 3 seconds before the end of the recording. A CVR group comprised of technical experts will convene in the near future at the NTSB headquarters in Washington, D.C. to review the entire cockpit voice recording and accident recording, and they will produce a written transcript. The CVR transcript will be made public when a majority of the other factual reports are placed in the NTSB's public docket for this accident. I know you're going to have a lot of questions on this, but this is all that we are authorized to say at this time about the CVR data. We'll now move on to power plants. And we've recovered both engines, the propeller assemblies from the accident site, and they have been moved. Dr. Rohde, would you address that section, please?
Absolutely. So both engines were recovered from the airframe yesterday. Both propeller assemblies were recovered from the accident scene yesterday, and they're now in a secure hangar where our team is taking the external components and airframe pieces off of the engines so that they can examine both engines further and clearly identify which propellers assemblies belong to which engines.
Thank you. In the operations group, we have requested and will be beginning the review of the flight crew records, their certificates, their logbooks, and recent flight experience. We've interviewed several witnesses and other pilots, including another pilot who flew with the accident pilot several weeks before the flight, the accident flight, on a flight from Teterboro, New York. He reported that there was nothing unusual at that time. We have additional video recordings now. We have four videos, and we have two that were taken from the end of the runway, and one from another hangar that shows the ground roll and liftoff of the accident aircraft. The last video that we have is from a parked fire truck that is having a dash cam looking west towards the hangar, and that shows the aircraft shortly before it collides and then after it collides with the hangar itself. You had some questions yesterday regarding the weight of the aircraft, and Dr. Rohde has some information on that.
It's standard in an accident such as this for us to conduct performance calculations regarding the airplane, what was the airplane capable of doing versus what we are seeing in the accident videos and where the airplane ended up, specifically with a concern for performance of one of the engines. So we will conduct a standard weight and balance calculation. We know the airplane has capacity for 11 people and 10 people were on board. We will take estimated weights for all of the occupants. We will weigh everything inside of the airplane that we were able to recover, noting that most items are fire damaged and that will not provide us an exact weight, rather an estimated weight. We know that the airplane was topped off, so as we move forward, we will understand what the fuel tank configuration was and exactly how much fuel could be on board. And based on past maintenance history, we'll be able to take the empty weight of the aircraft and include that in our weight and balance calculations.
On the air traffic control side, we conducted a site visit to the tower yesterday, and that gives our people an opportunity to observe what the controller saw. We will also be reviewing the air traffic control recordings from their side, so that gives us two vantage points on control or on the aircraft recording. So we've got the CVR data, and we will also have the ATC tapes. And then we are scheduled to have two interviews with the air traffic controllers that were on duty today. So that should happen now. On the drone team, we are documenting the damage to the hangar and also getting a very good look at what is scattered up on the roof of the hangar, which is unsafe currently now for our people to go up to inspect. Obviously, we will need to recover all of that data. And we're also looking very closely at the scars on the hangar floor, which will describe the path of the aircraft and some of the parts and pieces. And we also have to separate out some of the aircraft that were parked in the hangar, the Falcon 50, and the accident aircraft to make sure that we have things properly done there. The last thing that the drone will do is to fly an approximate path of the accident aircraft based on air traffic control data and off of the ADS-B track. So we'll now take your questions. Again, please raise your hand when I call on you. State who you are with and your name, and we'll go from there. Sir.
Question. You use the word confusion as the describer of the CVR, can you kind of explain what that means or what?
As I stated, I cannot give you any more data than that. I will read the statement again. That's all I'm allowed to provide. It says, crew comment consistent with confusion occurred about 12 seconds before the end of the recording. Crew comment regarding a problem with the left engine occurred about 8 seconds before the end of the recording. So that's all we are authorized to release. When we get the transcript published in the docket, then you'll be able to read precisely what the crew was saying. So I realize that doesn't give you as much as you would like, but that's all we can release at this time. Yes, sir.
Jason Allen, CBS 11 here in Dallas-Fort Worth. Can you give us any context of what an automated bank oral alert is so we can understand that term?
Do you have any thoughts on that?
Again, we're restricted by federal law on what we can elaborate right now. That's the only description that we can provide. And we do that for the protection of the protection of everybody involved from the standpoint that we want to make sure that it's 100% accurate before we release specific details.
One of the things that will happen when we publish the accident report, because we write for two audiences, we write for the lay audience and we write for the technical audience, is that all of that will be described in great detail in the accident report. Yes, sir.
Since you have to go with NBC5, any idea about how much longer your folks will actually be out on the ground here doing stuff here versus, you know, heading back to DC and doing a lot of the analysis stuff?
Well, I can tell you that the headquarters team will be departing this afternoon. This will be our last formal briefing. Dr. Rohde?
So my team will likely remain through Thursday here on scene. We're still in the process of going through the wreckage, examining the wreckage. Our goal, due to the events tomorrow afternoon here at the airport, is to be finished around 3 or 3:30, but we are not going to rush our job based on those events. If it takes longer, it takes longer. But I'd say we'll be at minimum here through Thursday on the board.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
So if you are just joining us right now, we are getting an update, a press conference here from the NTSB on the Addison plane crash that happened on Sunday, killing everyone, all 10 people on board. And there is a lot to go through this afternoon, and we'll make sure that we keep you updated at WFAA.com and, of course, our app, because they're talking about a lot of investigation that still has to take place, including being on the scene until Thursday, just to make sure they recover all the pieces and go ahead and actually separate the pieces of the plane from the actual pieces of the hangar. And they're going through that wreckage right now. Lone Star Retrieval in Lancaster is going to be picking up those pieces so they can decipher all of that and then reconstruct that. So right now, though, we are hearing because of some information they have released, they have yet to release a transcript of the audio recording, but there was crew comment that there was a left engine problem, and there are apparently three auto bank angle alerts that were heard. Again, this is just new information that we're getting in right now from that press conference from the NTSB. The NTSB will investigate, but they say it could take up to a year to come up with a reason the plane crashed. And if you're listening to this press conference, you can understand why. They're looking at actually taking a drone back through and looking at the flight path, the approximate flight path, and they're talking to people on the ground. They're looking at four different videos that were recovered, so a lot to get through, and we'll make sure that we break it all down for you on our website, through our app, and of course tonight at 4, 5, and 6 o'clock. But that again is the update from the NTSB.